What is up, guys? DZF here, and today I have a very exciting video with a very exciting guest. So there are a lot of really great high value cards out of Rise of the Duelist. You have all those super expensive secret rares, but in today's video I've brought Asala from Duelist Academy, which we'll link in the description below, and we're going to talk about some of the more underrated cards in the set. Duelist Academy is a fantastic Patreon for any Yu-Gi-Oh player at any level. They have deck doctors, they have coaches, they have videos every single week. And right now, one of their biggest selling points is the very low-priced community tier at just $5 a month. This tier is great. It gets you access to Discord, where you can talk with other people on Duelist Academy, including the coaches. And included in that $5 price, you get 4 tournaments every single month. That is a lot of value. These tournaments have great prizing. 2 of them are box tournaments. 2 of them give you merchandise and coaching perks. It is a really great tier to get in at the ground level and then maybe move on up to the higher tiers later on. Asala, feel free to introduce yourself and tell the good viewers what Duelist Academy is all about.
Yeah, hi, Asala here. So at Duelist Academy, we mainly just want to give back to the community and help other people grow and give the community a chance to get all the knowledge that a lot of the pros kind of just kept to themselves. Like, the point of our Patreon here is we want to give more to the community and give everyone a chance at like really improving their game. And this is something that I noticed when I was developing as a player, is I got better because I was just surrounded by some of the greats of the time. Playing with them helped me improve so much. And I feel like that is one of the keys to getting better as a player, is just learning from those that are doing really well at the time to becoming the next great yourself.
Yeah, I mean, that makes perfect sense. And I think what we really wanted to do in today's video was show you guys, if you had any misconceptions about Duelist Academy only being like meta players, we're talking about underrated cards, not the big cards that people are talking about with Rise of the Duelist. We're spending the time to look at some cards maybe not everyone knows about, just to show you guys that Duelist Academy is a very versatile Patreon and they can help you with all sorts of strategies. The first card in today's video, or the first pair of cards, is Edgem's Scythe and then Fright for Cruel Whale. So these are 2 new Fluffle support cards, and man, are these cards exciting. Scythe is sort of like a hand trap, lets you fusion summon on your opponent's turn, which is insanely powerful, and Cruel Whale is a perfect monster to summon. In many situations, it pops a card on either side of the field, and it's a great level 9 monster that you can use to make cards like True King of All Calamities. Asala, how do you feel about these new Fright for cards, these new Fluffle cards?
I am honestly just super excited about just all these Fluffle support. I've always felt like Fluffle was that rogue deck that was so scary to play against, right? Like, if you ever queue up against Fluffle, you felt like if you didn't do enough on your turn one, they just killed you. They kill you through anything. But like, that was, I think, one of the big concerns with the deck before, is that it didn't have enough of a turn one setup. And with these new cards, they can do a lot turn one now. So they can just make these really unbreakable boards turn one, or going second, still have all that crazy power in just being able to OTK. And I think Scythe does a lot for the deck because it's one of those cards that just cheat out fusion summons, where like fusion summoning was a mechanic that you have to just commit a spell card and 2 monsters to do, so it wasn't always the best. You just have to mitigate that with having effects from the cards that you fusion summon with. But this card is just perfect because it acts as the spell itself as well as a fusion material for it, and then being a quick effect on top of that, it just does so much. Not to mention how it pairs specifically with Fright for Whale, where you use this on your opponent's turn to summon Whale. Whale pops a card on both sides of the field, but then Scythe also has an additional effect where you can banish it in the graveyard to protect one of your Fright for monsters from being destroyed. So moving on to the next card on our list, this is one of the ones that not even just myself, but everyone in Duelist Academy is super excited about. I can go as far as to say it's my favorite card in the entire set, and that's Ice Dragon's Prison. So let me just give you a brief overview of what this card actually does. It's a trap card. Target one monster in your opponent's graveyard, special summon it to your field, but negate its effects. Then you can banish 2 monsters with the same type as each other, one from each side of the field, and then you can only use it 1 per turn. So the key impacts of this card, right? Like, immediately you can think of how insane this card is in the Eldlick matchup. Like, you get to just use this card when they're like, let's say, Chaining Conquistador, or just like any time in the game, to summon back a lord from their graveyard. And if they have a lord on the field or a conk on the field, like any of their golden lands even, you get to banish both. Imagine having a double DD Crow in this sense. And then if you're playing Eldlick yourself, then you just get to like steal a lord to trigger your conk effects or like any of your golden lands. But like, more so than just the Eldlick matchup, you have the broken interactions with just any combo deck, but because of how flexible this card is. It has, the only thing it targets is the monster in the graveyard. The banishing effect itself does not target, and it banishes, right? So it's just really, really good removal. And you can use this against, let's say, at Emancipator, where you like target something in their grave, summon it back to your field, banish their block dragon so they don't get their searches, and that cuts them off severely. Or against the Rocket deck, you just get to target a dragon and then banish, let's say, the random dragon in a Romulus that just got equipped with a Dragoonity Lance. Like, there's so much you can do because of how flexible this card is.
Oh, and also what's cool is that even if you take the monster, that doesn't necessarily have to be the monster that you banish. You don't have to take a zombie and then banish it immediately. Maybe your opponent has different monsters on the board. You can take something and then banish one of your other monsters if your opponent has a monster on the field with the same type. Might not come up that often, but could be pretty cool in certain matchups. Next up, we have Lifeless Leaf Fish, which is kind of a tongue twister, but this card is really, really cool. When this card is summoned, you can send one fish monster from your deck to the graveyard, except itself, and you can banish this card from your graveyard, then target three fish monsters in your graveyard, shuffle those monsters into your deck, then draw one card, and then of course it is a hard once per turn. Fish monsters actually have a lot of support, as do water monsters generically, and I think that this card will be a huge boost to a lot of strategies. You guys might have even seen MBT Yu-Gi-Oh! Use this card not too long ago in his crazy fish combo deck just a few days ago. This card might breathe new life into many older archetypes, any of them that are using strong fish monsters.
And yeah, to build off of that, if you just consider how good it is to have any kind of Armageddon Knight effect in a given theme, there's a lot you can do with it, especially with like just future support, right? This card is not necessarily future-proof because of that. So maybe there's not so much to do with fish types right now, but in the future, if there's anything really good to send, this card is going to be immediately valuable. Things to keep in mind just for right now, any of the fish wargs are cards that you can send with this, but more notably, you can send Deep Sea Coelacanth and then like find a way to summon that back. And don't forget, you can use the Lifeless Leaf Fish to protect the Coelacanth using Coelacanth's effect to negate cards that target. With Coelacanth and this card, let's say you dump Coelacanth and summon it back by some means, you can use it and then summon a bunch of Oystermeisters, and that card just summons tokens. So I'm sure there's like just crazy things you can do as far as like water fish combos just because this card exists, and you can like find ways to dump cards in the graveyard, because then all you have to do is just have any level 4 extender, right? And you can just summon Dugarris and summon a monster back, and then that's like a cool combo that you can do. And then next on our list, we have Megalith Foal. So this card is really interesting. It's very similar to Edgem Saber in the fact that it cheats out a ritual summon. So this is something that Megalith kind of needed. It follows Megalith's theme. There are many of them that cheat out the ritual summon by the monsters themselves being the ritual spell to use as the tribute. But then this card not only counts itself as the ritual, so you can use it as a quick effective ritual summon, but you also get to ritual summon a monster from the deck.
This new card might actually push the strategy to be a rogue level deck. And then we have Blizzard. Now, when this card was first revealed, I saw a lot of discussions around it, but now that we're getting closer to the Rise of the Duelist release, I feel like people have sort of forgotten about this card. I believe it was one of the earlier reveals, but this thing is still really appealing. Basically, it stuns a spell card that's face up, and that's really useful against a variety of really powerful spells. Sure, they get a chance to use that card again next turn because it bounces it back to their hand, but hopefully by that point you have regained control of the duel and maybe have a negation. Things like Lightning Storm or Dark Ruler No More or even Twin Twisters are all great cards to hit with Blizzard because it blocks them for the entire turn. I've used cards like a Pointer of the Red Lotus, as have many other players, against cards like those, but Blizzard might be a better option in many cases because you don't have to pay 2,000 life points, you don't have to reveal your hand, and also you don't even have to have a hand in general.
So moving on to Adai's Revolution Dragon, this card is an import from, I don't even know how long ago. We were supposed to have this card back in like 2018, it feels like, and this was meant to be used in some of like, this would have been just crazy to have in Pendulum FTK format because it's meant to be used to search out Darkworm. You can pay 500 life points to discard this card from your hand to add a Dragon Pendulum from your deck to your hand, level 8 or lower. But this still has synergies now that the prize card, Chaos Emperor, is available to everyone in its recently released in Battles of Legend. So you still have quite a lot you can do, and it still searches Darkworm to do cool effects with that. And just having this effect in grave can be really good. Obviously, you can't use Starving Venom to copy its effect anymore. Its pendulum effect isn't as relevant, but just the fact that you can target a dragon, basically extra deck monster in your graveyard, destroy it, and special summon that monster that you targeted can be very, very important. because of cards such as the next card.
Yeah, so the last card that we're looking at in today's video is Chaos Ruler, the Chaotic Magical Dragon. This card is very reminiscent of the Adamancipator Synchro Monsters, and that is a huge compliment. Instead of excavating for rock monsters, you're excavating for light and dark monsters, and the rest of them do not go to the bottom of your deck, but rather the graveyard, which is a huge deal. There is a lot of consistency boost in this effect, and it does make a huge difference for pretty much any chaos strategy, not to mention the fact that it is a generic synchro monster, so you can pretty much make this with anything in your deck.
One of the most exciting things for me personally about this card is it kind of eliminates a lot of the chaos issues that chaos decks had, when that you had to have these really bricky chaos monsters in your opening hand sometimes, because you have to play them just to get their beneficial effects, and you want to have all the things to banish in your graveyard as well. So at what point, what is the right mix, right? How do you not brick? Like, that was the huge issue. If you just play level 8 Synchro Turbo, which is much easier to do, this card kind of gets you to everything you need, because it provides that chaos effect in the graveyard to summon itself back, which is really important in bringing life back into somewhat dead archetypes like our personal favorite Thunder Dragon. Like, we can do so much even without Colossus in just playing rank 8 spam by having this card banishing your darks and your Thunder Dragon Roars.
Chaos Ruler, the Chaotic Magical Dragon, has huge potential at competitive events, as do all the cards mentioned in today's video. Make sure to check out the Duelist Academy Patreon, there will be a link in the description below, and make sure to let us know in the comment section which one that we talked about in today's video was your favorite card. Thank you guys so much for watching today's video, thank you to Asala for joining me from Duelist Academy, and make sure to check out Duelist Academy, a link will be in the description below. Asala, if people request you for coaching assistance, what can they usually expect?
So basically, we cover all things from intro level to even professional level. If whatever you really want to improve upon, we usually start with deck building, getting some of the key concepts out there. I know a lot of people have struggles with siding, and then we go into technical play and just work through your gameplay and how you can sequence your plays better. I know a lot of people have specific issues with playing into back row or just going second, and that's some of the stuff that we pride ourselves in being able to help people overcome.
As you could see, the Duelist Academy does not only deal with meta strategies, they have tons of knowledge about other decks as well. I'll see you guys later. Thank you so much for watching. Goodbye.